Good afternoon or good morning, whatever time of day it is for you. Good afternoon, good afternoon, evening, whatever. Welcome to Oasis of Love Sunday Worship. It's been a while, so I've kind of forgotten the greeting. I'm back from college, and I'll be here for a while until January time. So that's good. Join us as we worship. We're thankful that it was Thanksgiving the past couple of days ago. We're thankful for life. We're thankful that God brought us here as far as 2020 so far, and that we will make it till the end of the year and unto next year and for many years to come. So join us as we worship today. Confusion's my companion, and despair holds me for ransom. I will feel no fear. I know that you are near. When I'm caught deep in the valley, with chaos for my company, I'll find my comfort here. I know that you are near. My help comes from you. You're right here pulling me through. You carry my weakness, my sickness, my brokenness all on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help comes from you. You are my rescue. I don't have to see to believe that you're lifting me up on your shoulders, no matter what once was shattered, and you turn my tears to laughter. Your forgiveness is my fortress. Oh, your mercy is relentless. My help comes from you. You're right here pulling me through. You carry my weakness, my sickness, my brokenness all on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help comes from you. You are my rest, my rescue. I don't have to see to believe that you're lifting me up on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help is from you.
Don't have to see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't have to see, cause you know it's true.
From you,
don't see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know it's true.
My help comes from you.
You right here pulling me through.
You carry my weakness, my sickness, my brokenness all on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help comes from you. You are my rest, my rescue. I don't have to see to believe that you're lifting me up on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help is from you.
Don't have to see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know it's true.
It's from you.
Don't see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know
my
it's
help
true.
It's from you.
Don't see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know
my
it's true.
From you.
Don't see to believe it.
My help.
can't see, cause I know it's true.
Oh, yeah. Praise the Lord. Now we're welcoming Pastor. We're going to sing that last part again. My help is from you.
My help is from you.
Don't seem to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know it's true.
It's from you.
Don't see to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't see, cause I know my help comes from you. You're right here pulling me through. You carry my weakness, my sickness, my brokenness all on your shoulders. Your shoulders. My help comes from you. You are my rescue. I don't have to see to believe that you're lifting me up on your shoulders, my help is from you.
Don't have to see it to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't have to see it, cause I know
my
it's
help
true.
Help is from you.
Don't have to see it to believe it.
My help is from you.
Don't have to see it, cause I know it's true.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. My help comes from you. Glory, 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 glory. My help comes from you. How many of us can say that this morning? That our help comes from Him. How many of you can say that? Can you say that? Can I say that? My help comes from Him. We just had Thanksgiving. Amen. Just barely a few days removed from Thanksgiving. And it's been a tough year, 2020, but God has been faithful. God has been faithful. God has been faithful. And indeed, our help comes from Him. Amen. The Bible says in Him we live, move, and have our being. Therefore, our help, we look up to Him. We look up to Him. Hallelujah. The Bible says, will I look up to the hills? Does my help come from Him? It says, no. My help comes from the one who made heavens and the earth, not from the hills. I don't look at physical circumstances. I look up to Him. My help comes from Him. Hallelujah. Thank you for joining us for Oasis of Love Worship, Sunday Worship. It's a joy and delight to be with you. I'm Apostle and Bible Teacher Nnamdi Norm of Fountain of Life International. My daughter just came from college, Uzoma. You heard her join us and join the worship. I mean, the song that was sang with Ezioma, and I trust that you guys were blessed as partook in that song. And declare that our help is from Him. Our help comes from Him. Amen. Hallelujah. We just believe it and we know it. This morning, we're going to be sharing some things that will really be a blessing to you. I trust it will be a tremendous blessing. I'm sorry we came on late. We had some technical things to deal with and we came on a bit later than we had supposed to come out by 11 o'clock. It's 11:42 now. But thank you for joining us for some love worship. Do me a favor. Invite somebody else to join. Amen. Just link and share the link. The link was just shared there on the screen. Just share with somebody else. Bring on somebody, bring your family, bring your friend on to share, to be a part of this worship experience. It's going to be a powerful time today. What God has for us today is going to be awesome. I want to just make some announcements ahead of time. Amen. Next weekend, we're going to be doing School of Leadership and Discipleship, a session next weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. We're going to be talking about hearing the voice of God, how to hear the voice of God. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Normally, we do it throughout the month. We do it every Saturday, but this time around, we do it just one weekend, Friday evening, Saturday evening, Sunday, regular service time. Friday evening, 7 p.m., Saturday evening, 7 p.m., that's Eastern Standard Time, and then Sunday, we're going to do it at this same time. And let me also make this announcement in advance. From next year, our services are going to be at 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. We kind of jumped from 12 to 1. Today we're on by 11:30 technically. But from next year, we're going to be starting at 10 o'clock, unless we have to minister somewhere else, you know, but we're going to be starting at 10 o'clock. That's going to be our standard time. So I'm going to keep it that way. Amen. So I would also want to encourage you, join me during the week. This week, I'm going to be sharing some things leading up to the weekend about hearing the voice of God. I'm going to be sharing some things, some basic things that are going to be very necessary, because what tends to happen is that when you're when you're doing a seminar or teaching, there needs to be some foundational stuff that's put in place. And I found out that many times, some of the things that we share, people don't, I don't say they don't understand it, but people are not able to receive properly, because sometimes where they worship, unfortunately, some certain foundational issues are not put in place. So when we share, it kind of speak above the head of the people. I'm not trying to make it boasty. I'm just telling you what I've experienced and what I've observed. So what we do instead is that we make sure that during the week, we're going to, During the week, we're going to make sure that we, you know, we lay some foundational stuff, and then we can, so we can part in on Friday. Don't forget, Friday, 7 p.m., Saturday, 7 p.m., and Sunday, we're going to be on at 11 a.m., dealing with understanding, or how to hear the voice of God. How to hear the voice of God. It's a school of leadership and discipleship initiative, which means that it is a mentorship initiative, and it will be a blessing to you, guaranteed. I have flyers out during the week. Thank you again for joining us, Ejima. Thank you for you and your sister singing that song. My help comes from you. So today we're going to get into God's word, but let's start with a word of prayer. And I also want to say something else. I got so much announcements to kind of lay before we get into that. Please, if you have any questions, biblical questions, anything you don't understand in scriptures, you can send me a message. I mean, here Facebook, you can go on Facebook Messenger and shoot me a message. Pastor, apostle, whatever you want to call me, you know, can you explain this scripture to me? And all that, can you explain that? And it will be a joy and delight to share with you, because as a Bible teacher, one of my assignments as a Bible teacher is to bring understanding to people. One of the ways you gain understanding is by asking questions. If you don't ask questions, you still remain in the dark. A lot of people are struggling because of lack of understanding. In fact, Hosea 4:6, my people perish for lack of knowledge. And because they don't understand, if you look at the Colossians 1, you're going to see that then, because of lack of understanding, people are not able to apprehend the riches of Christ. So I want to make sure that we make that available also, and I'll be talking about that in the coming weeks and months also. So much that's happening, so much that God has been speaking to us about that's going to come in the new year. I want to just prepare your mind for that, for those things. Amen. Praise the Lord. So we're going to dive into God's word today. Let's share a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this privilege and opportunity we have to sit down on the table of your word. Thank you, Father, because the entrance of the word brings light, understanding to the simple, and faith comes by hearing by the word of God. Holy Spirit, as I anoint every ear to hear your word today, anoint every heart to receive, every eye to see. Lord, speak through me, think through me, cause your words to come for simplicity and clarity. Thank you, Father, because faith comes, and thank you because the blessings are ours. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Do me a favor, invite somebody else to share, to be a part of this experience. I always say this to people, if you find a great restaurant, what do? You tell your friends about it. I don't know about you, that's what I'll do. If I find a great place, it's a great deal, I share with other people, and my friends do that with me also. And I trust that if you've been a part of this ministry, received from us, you know, hey, what we share is a blessing to people, a blessing to you. So do me a favor, invite a friend, a family member to be a part of this, and I trust that God will reach them just as he's reaching you. Amen. So today we're going to be talking about the simplicity of asking and receiving. The simplicity of asking and receiving. The simplicity of asking and receiving. Wait, who's over? Please tell her to come up. Something else to let that, you know, to kind of give it distracting. But, you know. Okay. Please call Zawa Tisha. The simplicity of asking and receiving. Glory to God. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Matthew 7 and 7. The simplicity of asking and receiving. We're going to read from 7 to verse 11. I'm privileged to have my Bible reader, my daughter Ezioma, she's here. She's going to read that scripture for us. Matthew 7, from 7 to 11. What do you have? What version do you have?
King James version.
King James. The good old King James. KJV. Let's go.
Ask and it shall be given you. Mm-hmm. Seek and ye shall find.
Yep.
Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth,
yep.
And he that seeketh findeth.
Yep.
And to him that knocketh it shall be opened.
Okay.
Or what man is there of you, whom if his son ask bread, he will give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good things to them that ask him?
That's all. The Bible makes it very clear. It said, ask and you shall receive. Jesus speaking and said, ask and you shall. See, sometimes we don't understand the meaning of words. Now, I'm not trying to insult you, but the word shall is a combination of the word should and the word will. Will and should is what combined to make shall. Shall. Okay. Should means definitely would happen. Should means it may happen. Most likely to happen. But the word will means a choice that will happen. Okay? So should, okay, it should rain today. Does not mean it's going to rain. Okay? The clouds are dark. It should rain today. It might not rain. Okay? That's what the word should is. That means there's a probability factor to it. When you use the word should, that word speaks about probability of something happening. It should rain today. I should get my paycheck. That's a probability, okay? But the word will has to do with a choice. I will go. That means a choice. So when the Bible says shall, combining those two words, should and will, it's a definitely strong possibility. It's a very definite, strong thing that's going to happen. That means God has made up his mind that he's going to do it. That's will. And then it should happen. It should means probability. But then when God makes up his mind about probability, that's a double positive right there. Okay. When first of all, it says it should happen. Okay. That's if you ask, you should receive. That means probability. But then it says will. That even makes it stronger. Because now God is the one that makes sure you receive. So that God is saying, I've made up my mind that possibility will happen. See what I'm saying? You're coming to God, says, ask and you shall receive. You've come to God and God says, my will, I've made up my mind, I'm going to get it. Okay? And then he also says, that probability will come to pass. So it's important we understand that. So it says, ask and you shall receive. Ask and you shall, means you are rest assured, you can be confident that whenever you ask, you'll receive. Seek, you'll find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Then he said something there. The next verse there. Read that second, the next verse after that. Read that, please.
The one that's...
After the asker, you shall receive. Verse 8. Read verse 8.
For everyone that asketh, receiveth. And he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened.
For everyone that asketh. That's the key. For everyone. That means that... Listen very carefully. Listen to this. The condition for receiving is not dependent anymore on God. I've said that again. The condition for receiving is not dependent anymore on God. Because God says, on my part here, it's my will that that probability will happen. It's my will that that which was possible, was probable before, is now definite. That's the word. God says, it's my will that that which was probable before, is now definite. So the question, the issue now is this. You are not the one asking. That's the problem. I'm not the one asking. That's the problem. It's not about God deciding to give you or not give you. See, religion tells us that when you pray to God, God can, if God's in a good mood, God will do it. If God's in a bad mood, for whatever reason, he's not going to do it. So there's always a question about God doing something based on sovereignty. Listen, let me say this very carefully. Let me say this clearly. This issue of asking and receiving is not an issue of sovereignty. It's not an issue of because God in his sovereignty, God has said, it's my will to answer your prayer. It's my will to provide for you. It's my will to open the doors to you. It's my will. So sovereignty has been taken care of. God has, you know, we're not sovereignty. Let me define sovereignty. Sovereignty is the ability, that means word. It's God deciding to do whatever he wants to do, to whoever he wants to do it, whenever he wants to do it, to whoever, whenever, however. That's sovereignty. That means it's God has supreme choice about what to do. That's what sovereignty is. So this question, this issue of asking and receiving in Matthew 7:7 has nothing to do with sovereignty. The sovereignty question has been answered already. He said, it's my will. Okay, look at 3 John 2. We're going to go back here, but look at 3 John 2. It's only one chapter, verse 1.
3 John.
Yeah. So sovereignty is not the issue. This is not a sovereignty thing. I'm going to explain to you why. 3 John 2. Read it, Gemma.
Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth.
I desire, I will, I wish. If you read our translation, you're going to see that. I desire, I wish, I will that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. That means that God's desire, God's will, this is not a choice thing, as it were. That means God's choice already set. God's choice is that you prosper. So the question of prosperity is no longer left up to God. It's left up to us, because God said, he has made it clear, he has made it clear that this is will.
Amen.
God has made it clear that this is will. God's will is that you prosper, is that I prosper. God's choice that you prosper, that you prosper. God's sovereign will is that you prosper and that I prosper. God says, my choice, my will is that every time you ask me, I will respond to you. Look at Jeremiah 33, verse 3. Jeremiah 33, verse 3. Every time you ask, every time you ask. Verse 8, that's what it says. But look at Jeremiah 33, 3. Read for us, please.
Call unto me and I will answer thee.
Call unto me and I will answer you. Hold on. I will answer you. That means God is saying, every time you call on me, my sovereign choice, my sovereign decision is to answer. That means that it's no longer left on the God side. It's not on the God side anymore. It's now my part. When you call on me, I will. My choice, my sovereign will, my decision is to answer. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Glory to God. Read for us, please. Read on.
And show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not.
And show you great and mighty things. He said, my will, my sovereign choice is to answer you and show you great and mighty things that you don't know. Which means that, listen, if I'm not experienced, if you're not experiencing great and mighty things, it's not because it's God's choice. It's because you have not asked. Because you have not called on him. Because you have not done your part. What God says is that this is an equation. If you do your part, I'll do my part. If you do your part, I'll do my part. My part is to respond. Your part is to ask. If you don't ask, then you don't get my response. Go back to Matthew 7. Go back to Matthew 7. Let's go there. We just read verse. Read verse 8 and then read further from 8.
For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened.
For everyone that asketh, that means if you dare to ask, he said you receive. If you dare to knock, it'll be open. If you dare to seek, you'll find. So it's not about God. It's not about God holding back. It's about you daring to ask. It's about you being bold enough to ask. It's about you now. It's about me now. It's not about God. It's not God saying, I'm holding back from you. I'm holding back from you. Or you asking. Listen, God's not a tease. You know what a tease is? A tease is, let's ask something now. Try and get this phone. Come on, take my phone. That's not how God does. That's a tease. God is saying, if you ask, you will receive. God is saying, if you ask, is you're going to take my phone, you will receive. You see, God, on the God side of the equation, he has released the phone. It's up to you to take. In fact, he's willing. It's in his hand, but it's just loose right there. Take the phone. That's how it is. That's how it is. God says, I've given you the phone. So if you put it back in my hand, if you don't take it, whose fault is it? Whose fault is it? Exactly. Why? Because you are not taking it. Read on, verse 9.
Or what man is there of you, whom if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? Mm-hmm. Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent?
If you notice the scripture, and the basis, now, this way I'm going, this message, the basis for asking and receiving is relationship. The basis for asking and receiving is relationship. He said, what man is it of you? If his son ask him for bread, give him a stone. Ask a fish, give him a serpent. What the basis for simply asking and receiving is relationship. It's relationship. Hallelujah. That's the basis for it. The basis that you and I can have confidence every time I ask, I receive, is because I have a relationship with him. Real.
If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children.
You see that again? If you and I, being human, that's what it means, being evil, the word evil that is human. Being human, subject to, you know, human frailty and failures, subject to not having enough. For example, if I want to give my child something, if I promise my child something, I promise them something, but I don't have the funds or the resources, that happens in the earth. Sometimes in the earth realm, we don't have the funds right away. Okay, so sometimes I say to the child, well, okay, I meant to give it to you, but you know, things have changed, so blah blah blah, I can't do it now. Okay, that's what it's talking about. If you, being human, will go out of your way to make sure you take care of your children, to make sure you respond to your child. Go ahead. How much more?
How much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask
him? It brings the word shall there again, which means that God's will in this issue is set. God's will is this. I'll give you the phone. God's will, that's what God's will. I'll give you the phone. That's God's will. The issue is for you and I to take, to ask, to ask. So now let's establish, look at John 1:12. Let's establish our relationship with God again. What's our relationship with God? That's important. Let's establish that. John 1:12. Read for us, please.
But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name.
To them, as many as received him, that's my part. He gave them the right. He gave them the right. He gave them the right. Okay? That means that to become a child of God is already something that God has given. So it's for me to receive. That's why John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, already given, that whosoever will believe on him will not perish. So there's a part, my part there is to simply this, come into that relationship in John 1:12 by receiving Jesus. So when you got born again and received Jesus as Lord and Savior, the Bible says God gave you the right, the authority to become a child of God, even as many as believed on his name. When you receive it by believing on his name, he said he gave you the right. He gave you the right. He gave you access into the relationship of sonship. He gave us access into this family. When you hear the word son and children, the concept is family. He gave me the right. He gave me the access to become a member of his family. Ephesians 2:19. He gave me the right to become a member of his family. Ephesians 2:19. Emma, read for us, please.
Ephesians 2:19. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone.
Read from the beginning again.
Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God.
Okay, leave it right there. It says that we're no longer citizens or foreigners, right?
You were no longer strangers and foreigners.
If you look at the NIV, say you're no longer an alien. You're no longer illegal. You're now a member of the family. Check out the NIV. Read NIV for us, please.
Okay. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers.
Okay, it says foreign. Another translation says aliens. I'm not sure which one, but one of them says aliens. You're not an alien anymore. You're not an outsider anymore. You're not an outsider. You are not a foreigner. You're not a stranger. Okay, you're not a stranger, but okay, I know where it's first Peter 2 that speaks about straight aliens. Okay, academics. First Peter 2 verse 9 to verse 11 speaks about that being, you know, we're no longer aliens. Okay, good. But the point is this: when you accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, you became a member of the household of God. Household meaning family of God. You are a member of the family of God. On the basis of being a member of the family of God, okay, you have access to everything that God the Father has. You have access to divine provision. You have access to these things. And therefore, God says all you have to do is to ask. This morning, why I was laughing earlier was because my son came up here and he began to do exactly what we're talking about. He has access to the cookies. He has access to the chips. So he comes in here and it's like in his mind, these folks are studying the Bible, okay, great, but I want cookies right now. So he went to his mom to ask for the cookies. He has access. He has a right to the cookies, a member of this household. He has a right to say, Mom, I want the munchies. I'm having the munchies. I want some cookies. So he came and he asked with confidence. He did not care that we're preaching. He did not care that we're in service. He came to his mom, to my wife, and said, I want the cookies. And mom had to attend. And listen, as long as he did not have the cookies, the boy did not leave. He was hobbling around like, when he now got the cookies, he now went to sit down. The point I'm trying to make sure, when you become born again, you have access to the cookies. Hallelujah. When you got born again, you are a member of the family of God. You have access to the chips. You have access to the cookies. And Father God has no other choice but to respond to you. That's what my son was doing. That's why I was laughing. Because he was just playing. I wish we could have put the camera on him. He play acted the summer right here. He felt, look, I have access to the cookies. I'm in this house. I want some cookies. I don't care what that is. I don't care what mom is doing. I want the cookies now. And what did we do? We responded to him. Hallelujah. That's exactly what it is in the family of God. When you've come in the family of God, you have access to God. You have access to the resources of God. And all God is saying to us to ask and you shall receive. Instead of murmuring, first of all, my son was murmuring downstairs, murmuring and grumbling. After him, as I said, nah, I can't do this anymore. I know they are preaching. I know they are in service. I'm going to come and interrupt them. I want my cookies. Listen to me, child of God. It doesn't, I'm going to say something. Somebody might say irreverent, but I'm going to say it. It doesn't matter what God is doing. It doesn't matter how God feels. Anytime you ask him, God says, I will answer you. Hallelujah. Anytime you ask him, he said, I will answer you. So the question is not about God's willingness to answer you. It's about you being confident and bold enough as a member of the family to say, Daddy, I want this. glory to God. Glory to God. Are you there? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, hallelujah. Now, let's look at 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. Glory to God. Glory to God.
Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when we shall appear, we shall be like him.
Okay, that's it. It says what? Beloved, now are we children of God. Now when we get to heaven. Let me say this again. Asking and receiving is not a sovereignty issue. What that means is that it's not left up to God. Asking and receiving is as simple as a child who is a member of a family, of household, asking their parents for things that belong to them. My son asking for cookies. That's why asking and receiving. It's that simple. It has nothing to do with the will of the parent. It has nothing to do with the will of God in this context. Why? Because God himself has said it in his word. It's my will. We saw in Jeremiah 33. Ask, call on me and I will answer you. You dare call, I will answer. You dare call, I will answer. It's not a sovereignty issue anymore. I know sometimes we've been taught that. That sometimes, God can say yes, Sometimes God says no, Sometimes God says not now, Sometimes God says you don't deserve it, God says how many times have you fasted, It's not about that. Now, is there a place for fasting and prayer? Absolutely. I'm going to explain that. I'm not going to really go heavy on that today. I don't want to get off on that rabbit trail. Okay, but it's very simple. Ask and you shall receive. Okay, now, in 1 John 3, 2, he says that now are we sons of God. Now are we sons of God. Now, not when we get to heaven. Now, this is very important because sometimes we've been told some things. We sang some songs. When I get to heaven, he'll wipe away the tears from my eyes. When I get to heaven, I'll have no need. When I get to heaven, Satan will not be able to get me. We've said those type of things. And those things are, listen, they are erroneous. Those things are not accurate, doctrinally speaking. How do I know that? In the Lord's Prayer, we pray it. As in heaven, let your will be done on earth. We pray it in the Lord's Prayer. If it was not possible, why are we wasting our time praying that? If it was not possible for you to enjoy heavenly experiences on the earth, Jesus deceived us when he said to us, when you pray, say, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in heaven, as in earth, as it is in heaven. Jesus deceived us. If it was not possible for us to have heaven on earth, he deceived us. And he did not deceive us. He's not a liar. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Sanctified by truth, thy word is truth. The word he spoke to us is the truth. And that truth is this. You can have heavenly experiences on the earth here by simply asking and receiving. As a child of God, by simply asking and receiving as a child of God. He said, listen, when you got born again, guess what really tried to happen to you? Your heaven and your earth fused together. Glory to God. When you got born again, your heaven and your earth fused together. You can overcome the devil here on the earth. You can live above sickness here on the earth. You can live above financial difficulty and lack here on the earth. You can live above sin here on the earth. You can live a heavenly lifestyle on the earth here. Amen. You can. Because he told us, ask whatever you... Okay, let's go a little bit. Do you know this? Look at Matthew. Matthew 15, from verse 22 through 29. Read for us, please.
And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast, and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Listen to this very well.
Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs.
The woman was asking for healing for her child. And Jesus said, it's not proper, it's not appropriate for me to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. Okay, what does that mean? He called healing the children's bread. He called healing the children's bread. He called healing the children's bread. I want that to settle your mind. Healing children's bread. Now, why is that important? Because in the culture in which they lived at that point in time, bread was basic. Bread was staple food. Bread was stuff you put on the table. Just like in many of our homes today, we have a bowl of fruit. We have fruit on the table. Anybody can go grab some fruit anytime. You can pick up a banana. You can pick up an orange. You can pick up whatever fruit you like in your house. Different things. Whatever it is you eat in your house. Orange, whatever it is. Grapes, whatever. You can just grab some. That's how healing was. Say, healing is the children's bread. Just like that fruit that I can even say, healing belongs to us like fruit on the table, like bananas on the table. So Jesus told that woman, it's not proper for me to take what belongs to children and give it to dogs. What belongs to children and give it to dogs. I'm telling you today that asking and receiving is based on relationship with God. It's based on the fact that you're a member of the family of God. You're a member of the household of God. And as a member of God's household, just like my son, you can ask and receive. You can say, can I get some bananas? Oh, yeah, go ahead. You can take the bananas. Oh, I want some grapes. Go ahead, I want some fruit. You can do that. Healing belongs to us the same way. Healing belongs to us the same way. Listen, you don't have to earn healing. You don't have to do anything else to deserve it because you are a member of the family. You are a child of God. You are a member of the household. My children, my son, did not have to do anything to deserve the cookies he got this morning. He was just born into the family. All he had to was to ask. All he had to was to ask. And if you notice, like I said before, he wasn't leaving until he got that fruit. He wasn't because like, look, this belongs to me. I got to get, listen to me, child of God. God wants you to have that same level of faith when dealing with him. That this thing belongs to me. Therefore, when I ask it, Jesus said, I will receive. So, Father, I'm asking in Jesus' name for this thing. It's that simple. You don't have to earn. You don't have to deserve. You don't have to do cartwheels. You don't have to make promises. Oh, Lord, I promise you if I do this, blah, blah. We don't have to promise. You don't have to. You don't have to. All you have to just take it. Let me also remind you of this. There's a principle called the principle of first things, okay? First principles in the world. When you're understanding the Bible, when you're trying to study the Bible, there's a principle of firsts, okay? When you see something that's the first in the Bible, the pattern, that sets a precedent for others. Now, let me give you a good one. If you look at Genesis 2, the Bible says that God made all the plants. He planted all the plants and all that stuff. Then he brought in the man. He set up everything good for food, good for looking at, and all that kind of stuff. God set up the whole Garden of Eden. I don't want to go into reading it. I don't want to kind of get off on that rabbit trail. But God set up everything. Look at it yourself. Genesis chapter 2. He set up everything and he put the man in it. He put the man in it. And then gave the man an assignment after that. Okay? He did not put the man first and then say, okay, now begin to plant the trees before you can eat the fruit. No. He set up everything. He set up everything and put the man in the middle of it. He set up everything and put the man in the middle of it. What am I saying to you? That when you become a born-again Christian, become a child of God, God has made provision for everything you need. First Peter tells us that. Everything for life and godliness, everything you need for life and godliness. God has made provision for every single thing that you need. It's all provided for. It's all taken care of. It's all made available to you. And all you have to do is simply ask and receive. I know how to make promises. I know how to do cartwheels. I know how to fast and pray. I know how to jump 20 times or 25 times. I don't have to even pay anything to get it. All I have to do is just take it and receive it. That's the basic level of asking and receiving. And that's available, accessible to everybody who believes. Everyone who's a child of God. It's accessible, available to everyone who's a child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's important we understand that. We need to stress that. Because one of the things we have done in the past is to put conditions to receiving things. Okay? Jesus told the woman, healing is the children's bread. No conditions. No conditions. Now, no conditions. I need to say that. Healing is yours without conditions. Healing is mine without. I don't have to do anything to earn. I don't have to do anything to earn. So, but Pastor, how about there are conditions? I'll tell you what the conditions are. And I'll show it to you right there in the scriptures. Hallelujah. I'm going to quickly make this. Sin does not disqualify you from receiving from God. These basics. I said again, sin does not disqualify you from receiving from God these basics. Now, let me explain that before someone says, Pastor, you're saying we can sin anyhow they want to sin. That's what I'm saying. Let me explain that quickly. Okay? When you get born again, you are a child of God. You are a child of God. Okay? If you want to read Hebrews 13:5, please hang in with me. Don't leave. Hebrews 13:5, read for us, please.
Hebrews 13, verse 5.
Yes.
Let your conversation be without covetousness.
Yes.
And be content with such things as ye have. Mm-hmm. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Mm-hmm. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me.
He said that let your conversation or lifestyle be without covetousness. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. If you notice that scripture, let's work on that scripture a little bit. He said that let your lifestyle be without covetousness, for he has said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Which means that even if your lifestyle is with covetousness, he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And you see what I'm saying? He's not saying having a lifestyle of covetousness disqualifies what he said. See, God saying is not conditioned upon you doing. God saying it's about his will. When God speaks his will. Okay, you line up with a different thing. But it said there, the second part there, I will never leave you. The word never means never. Never, ever, ever, never, ever, ever, never. That means under no circumstances, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I want that to really sink in. He did not say when you commit a sin, I'm going to leave you. This is not the Old Testament. We need to understand that. In the Old Testament, listen very carefully, the Holy Ghost did not live in them. He was upon them, and he was with them. He was upon them for service. He was with them as a people. Okay? He was upon them for service, anointing them to serve. And he was with them as a people. Okay? And then that's external. And that external presence, sin could affect that external presence. Remember when the Bible says that an evil spirit from Saul, evil spirit come upon Saul, and when that comes, Saul begins to behave irrationally. Okay, the Bible speaks about an evil spirit led David to count the people. So in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit could come and go based on sin. It was external. In the New Testament, this might sound unfair to the Holy Ghost, but guess what? He lives in you now. He lives inside you now. And the Bible says that I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will never leave you. He wrote that to the church. In case you don't know, the people in the Bible were not more holy than you. When we read the Bible, we think of this, you have been very holy. Everything in the Bible was this bunch of holy people. No, they were not. If you read the scriptures, if you read all the epistles, you see when Paul began to caution them about certain things. Don't do this. Don't do that. Even the Ephesian church that we all celebrate, if you read it very closely, you see that Paul cautioned them about certain things. Why would Paul write to them about those things? Because those were problems that Paul, as the apostle, saw in the church. So Paul saw that these churches had these problems. And Paul wrote the word of God to address those things. Okay? He wrote them to address those things. I'm saying that to say this to you and I, that God's provision, God's provision for us as his children are not conditioned on obedience or lack thereof. Now, I'm not saying we should not obey. Okay? And I'm going to show you, I'm going to mention, just mention the benefits of obedience, just a little bit, because I don't want to get into it. I don't want to be heavy on that. So I said, oh, that's the way you receive from God, by obeying. Okay? You receive from God because you are a child of God. Simply. You are a child of God. Very simply. You are a member of the household of God. Very simply. I have children here. My children don't do everything right. I don't deprive them of food. I don't deprive them of shelter. I don't deprive them of clothing. I make available the basics to my children. I don't say, oh, you did not wash the dishes well. One day we took a picture, my wife and I took a picture of a spoon that one of my kids, I'm not going to mention which of them, washed it. I have to show the child the picture. Okay? We supposedly washed the spoon, and the spoon had some stains on it. And it was right there. I was about to grab, say, oops, look at this thing. I took a picture of it. But listen to me, I did not tell that child, no dinner, no lunch, no breakfast. Go and sleep in the garage or sleep outside. I didn't do that because they didn't get it all right. You know what I'm saying? In fact, look at it. I've never mentioned it till now. And it's a couple of weeks ago. The child did, months ago. I don't want to go into, it's been a while ago. So, but the child did not even know. But we have not treated the child as though they don't deserve certain things because of a wrong they did or an imperfection in their character, imperfection in their performance. Okay, so I'm trying to say that to let you understand that once you come into the family of God, God is obligated to taking care of you. And the condition for God doing that is simply you asking and receiving. It's simply you asking. Okay, Pastor, how about if there's a problem? How about if I do something wrong? Listen, 1 John 1:9. Is it my read first? 1 John 1:9. 1
John 1:9.
Yes.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
When you acknowledge your sin, when you acknowledge your shortcoming, there's mercy. That's what I'm saying to you. There's mercy. When you acknowledge your shortcoming, there's mercy. So if I know I did something, okay, that's got my parents upset, okay, I want to maintain fellowship. Now, relationship, you're still my child. I'm not going to tell you go sleep outside. I'm not going to do that. But listen, I want to make sure that everything between me and daddy and mommy is smooth. What do? I'm sorry, Dad. I'm sorry, Mom. I want to make sure. That's right. But that does not mean daddy and mom are going to say, okay, because you did not wash that spoon well. Here's what's going to happen now. No breakfast, no lunch, no more school. You're going to sleep outside. No. If my child has asked me, daddy, I need, you know, something for school, I'm not going to say, you didn't wash the spoon, therefore I'm not. No. I need some new shoes. I'm not going to say, you didn't wash the dishes, therefore no shoes for you. No. The condition for asking and receiving is one. Simply, you are a member of the household of God. You are a member of the family of God. That's the basis. And then what do? You have to ask and receive. You have to ask and receive. In spite of your shortcomings, in spite of your imperfections, in spite of the fact you have not gotten everything right, okay? And let me say this to you. God runs the marathon with us. God does not run the sprint. God doesn't say, unless you change now, I will not bless you. Unless you change now, I will not heal you. Unless you change now, I will not deliver you. Unless you change now, I will not provide for you. That's not how God works. God works the marathon. Discipleship process is a process. Discipleship is a process. It's not instantaneous. And that's why, while I appreciate my brothers and sisters who are into deliverance ministries, I use the word deliverance in quotes because I'm also into deliverance ministries, but I understand it from my perspective, it will be gradual. You're delivered gradually. Every time you hear God's word, it's like you're dusting up some dirt. You dust up some dirt. Okay, praise God. You dust up some more dirt. Not a Shazam. Come to the service one day. We're going to deliver you and then come out here. We're going to hunt. Everything's going to, your taste for sin is going to die today. That's why people who are in deliverance type churches, there's a level of frustration that goes on with them. Okay, unless that deliverance is matched up with proper teaching. Follow proper teaching. There's a level of frustration if you're a deliverance church or deliverance ministry that does not have teaching and discipleship following it. It's very frustrating because you find that you are never ever able to match up. Because after you've been delivered from that habit, here's what's going to happen. Listen, Satan will be waiting for you outside. Okay? You've been delivered. You just came from a mighty deliverance service. It was great. It was awesome. You fell on the power of God. You threw up. You did all those things. Amen. Praise God. But when you go outside, guess who's waiting for you right there? Saying, I'm waiting for you. Same Satan waiting for you. So unless you are trained and taught on what to do when Satan shows up again, unless you are taught that, you find deliverance ministries without that balance of teaching cannot help you live, equip you rather, to live victoriously. Many Christians who are in deliverance ministries struggle. They keep struggling. They keep, I've not done enough. Why is this coming back? Maybe I'm not saved. Maybe I don't know the Lord. Maybe I'm not really delivered. And they go on and go on. Instead, realize that very simple. You have to build muscle strength against opposition. Satan, even when Christ was tempted, the Bible says Satan left him for a season. That means he came back. After Jesus Christ overcame Satan in the temple, in those three pivotal temptations we see in the Bible says Satan left him for a season. That means he came back. So what did Jesus do when Satan came back? Did he go for another deliverance session again? look at that. Read Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Hebrews 4, 16. So what do I do when I read it? What do I do when I err? 1 John 1, 9. Lord, I messed up. I goofed up. Lord, I sinned. I'm sorry. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for forgiving. Thank you for the cross. It's mercy provided. Lord, I receive your mercy. I receive your forgiveness in Jesus' name. That's what I do. Yeah, what's that? That's like I dusted up. And guess what? Get back up again. Get back in the fight. Listen, I'm being confident. Remember, your sufficiency, your confidence is not yourself. Amen. God says, if you confess your sins, I forgive. So God has declared that. And do you know how God forgives? When God forgives, guess what God does? He forgets it. So when you come back next time again, oh Lord, I did it again. God says, you did what again? That thing I confess. What's that? Because when God forgives, guess what God does? He takes it as, Bible says, he throws it to his back. He puts it at the bottomless pit, as far as it is from the west. God forgets it. Every time you confess your sin, shortcoming, wrongdoing to God, okay, or before God, acknowledge it and confess it. Here's what happens. God throws in the sea of forgetfulness. God forgets it. If you bring it up again, you are the one bringing it up, not God. You're the one bringing it up, not God. And that's what devil wants you. Devil wants you to stay in guilt and condemnation. Stay in there. Devil wants you to say, oh, see what you did yesterday. You're doing it again today. You see what you did? And then you not stay in guilt and condemnation. So here's the aim. The aim is this. So that you don't come back to ask and receive. Because now you're asking and receiving based on your performance. I told you before, asking and receiving is based on relationship as a child of God. It's not based on your performance. It's not based on I did everything right. I crossed every T, dotted every I. It's not based. It's based on I'm a child of God. I have a relationship with God. God is working on me. God is working. I'm a member of the household of God. He has provided for me as a member of the household. Therefore, I can come boldly. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Read for us, Hazy.
Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Let us therefore come boldly. He was writing to the Hebrews. He was not writing to a bunch of perfect people who have gotten everything right. You need to understand that the Bible, listen, I need to say this. I want this to sink in. The Bible was not written to perfect people. The Hebrews were not perfect folk. The Ephesians, the Philippians, the Thessalonians, they're not perfect folk. We need to understand that. Because if you don't understand that, you are setting a bar that the Bible does not set, that God does not set. You are setting up a bar that you yourself cannot reach. You are saying, until I get everything right, until I'm perfect, God can answer my prayers. That's not true. He said that, let us therefore, all of us, this is Paul, we believe, writing. Let us all therefore, all of us, including I, Paul the Apostle, let us therefore come to the throne of grace with confidence, with boldness. Read on, read again.
Let us therefore come boldly unto the
throne of grace. Boldly to the throne of grace. What does it say next? Go ahead.
That we may obtain mercy.
We may obtain mercy. What is mercy? Mercy is what I get when I deserve punishment. Come boldly to the throne of grace. That we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. I need money. I need healing. I need whatever I need. I come boldly. I'm messed up, Lord. But Father, I'm your son. I want that thing. Boom. God will give it to you. Lord, I messed up. Don't ever allow guilt make you not come to the throne of grace. Listen very carefully. This is why many Christians, now I'm going to make a very strong statement here. Many Christians don't receive from God when unbelievers do. I don't know if you noticed that. You somebody who, you know, she sleeps around, he sleeps around, he gets drunk, he cusses, he does everything stupid and crazy, but every time he has testimonies. He has things. Oh, and he might call it luck. Well, I was driving it. I was very lucky. Somebody will come to church. I even testify in church. So then we pray to God, and God will help them. And he said, but Lord, why is it that person who doesn't do anything right? They're the ones getting all the blessing. Me, I'm doing everything right. I'm struggling. You know why? Because when he comes to God, when she comes to God, he does not come based on their goodness. He comes based on mercy. But here you are coming and trying to think you have to earn your way to receive the blessing of God. You don't have to earn nothing. You are a child of God. Remember the household of God. Everything that's here belongs to you. All you have to do is to ask and receive it. If you messed up, simply say, hey, Lord, I missed it. But let me also say this to you. Please listen very carefully. I'm about to finish, but listen. Listen very carefully. Listen. Don't let Satan make you stay in guilt consciousness. Don't let Satan make you stay in guilt consciousness. All of us, every single person is being developed. We're all being discipled. We're all being worked on. Every single person. I don't care. That person looks very spiritual and very deep. That brother, sister who always walks around like, looking like they're very deep and very spiritual. When you say, hey, Brian, God bless you. You say, God bless you. They always look very deep and spiritual. God is working on everybody. Everybody. Don't be deceived. There's an area where God's working on them. Listen, that's why the basis for asking and receiving is not your deepness or your depth or your spirituality. It's you're a child of God. Don't ever allow yourself to say, I'm not fast. Maybe I'm not reading my Bible enough. That's why God has said my prayer. Maybe I'm not fasting enough. Maybe I'm not done. So don't let it. That's a lie from the devil. Don't believe that lie. All you have to simply is ask and you shall receive. Don't stay stitching. Listen. The Bible says the Holy Ghost will convict you of sin and righteousness. Don't stay, Lord, if there be any sin in me, reveal it. No, you're wasting your time. Lord, if there be any sin. Listen, that is your self-righteousness. That's your self. Get away from that. God has made you righteous. You are accepted in the beloved. You are acceptable and accepted in the beloved. You are accepted, acceptable because of the blood of Jesus. I wish I had time. Isaiah 53. The Bible says God has laid on him the iniquity of us all. God has laid on Jesus all my iniquity. He has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Therefore, when I come to God, I'm not coming with a guilt conscience, with a sin conscience. Maybe there's something wrong. Maybe that's what God has done. Maybe there's something, there's some secret sin. Lord, show me that secret sin in my life. Stop wasting your time. There ain't no secret sin there. Stop wasting your time. Simply ask and receive. If there's a problem, Holy Ghost will take care of it. Stop trying to do the work of the Holy Ghost. Are you hearing me, my brother, my sister? Don't do work. Just simply ask and receive. You are a child of God. Listen, the table is set. He said that, yea, though, in Psalm 23, yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I fear no evil. Why? You're with me. The rod and staff cover me. You prepare a table. The guy just came from valley of shadow of death. Guess what's waiting for him out of it? A table right there. Feast waiting right there. Oh, I don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. Maybe that's why I'm not getting here. Maybe I'm still single. I've not found a husband yet or a wife yet. Maybe that's why. Because I need to. God has to work me. And meanwhile, unbelievers who are getting smoke, who are smoking, getting high, sleeping around, doing everything, they are getting husbands and wives. But here you are. You are disqualifying yourself because you set up a qualification that the Bible does not set. Ask and you shall receive. Hitherto, Christ said, have you asked nothing in my name? Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. He didn't say, ask, fast, and receive. He didn't say, ask, be holy, and do everything right, and you shall receive. Simply, ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. James chapter 1. Now, what the qualification for receiving? It's a simple qualification. I said ask, but let's look at something. James chapter 1, verse 5. James 1:5-8.
If any of you lack wisdom,
if you lack money, lack health, if you lack wisdom, lack peace, go ahead.
Let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally.
Let him ask of God that gives to all liberally. He gives to all. That means he has an open hand. That's what it means. So liberal means he has an open hand. He gives in an open hand. He doesn't hold back. He's not a tease. He said, I take this. That's not what God does. He gives to all men liberally, has an open hand. Go ahead.
And upbraideth not, and it shall be given him.
Let him ask, and I told you the word shall. If you missed the beginning of this, message, go watch it again. The word shall. Two words: should, possibility; will, God's choice. So he's saying a shout is a combination of should and will, which means that God's choice is that this probability will happen. God's choice is that this probability will happen. Okay?
But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering.
So you see the qualification there? Let him ask in faith. So what does the devil do? The devil makes you to get out of faith, okay? By making you say, I've not done enough, I've not done enough, I've not done enough. So you put doubts in. You put doubt. See what I'm saying? You put doubt in. Maybe I've not done enough. I've not done enough. Maybe it's my past. In the past, I did this, I did that. That's what disqualified me from this today. No, no. He didn't say, ask about, ask. You know, ask. Let him ask in faith. Go ahead.
For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways.
That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Once you get born again, you are a child of God. You are a member of the household of God. God has, through the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and intercession of Jesus, God has made available everything that you need for life and godliness. Everything that you need. All you have to do is do what? Ask. That's what you have to do. Ask. 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 Stop disqualifying yourself. Stop this. I want the scripture on 2 Peter. 2 Peter. Is it?
Okay, 2 Peter.
Chapter 1. Verse 3. 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 3. Read for us, please.
According as his divine power hath given unto us.
Look at that.
Things.
Look at that. Sorry, you're running too fast. Slow it down. Slow it down. According as his divine power. This is God's power that has given unto us what? Look at this.
All things.
All things. All things. All things. All things. All things. All things. He has given. That means on the God end. This is it. He has given. He has given. He has given. Jesus said the kingdom of God is at hand. That means it's available to you. He has given. He has given us all things. Read on.
That pertain unto life and
that godliness. Pertain to life and godliness. All things. His divine power has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. All things. All things that pertain to life. Life means your natural life. Godliness means your God life. He has given unto us all things. Okay, go ahead.
Through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue.
Through our knowledge of him. The word knowledge there is relational knowledge. When you got born again, he has given you all things. He has given you all things. Relational knowledge through the knowledge of him who has called us. Is that knowledge is the calling into the family of God. Through the knowledge of him who has called us into the family of God. Hallelujah. There we go. That's the man. He has given us unto us all things. I know what he's looking for. He looked at the time. He's asking for his lunch. But anyway, let's oh my glory to God. He has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness. All things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him that's called us. The knowledge is the knowledge of calling. That means salvation. He has called us to glory and virtue. Read on.
Whereby are given unto us. Exceeding great and precious promises.
Exceeding great and precious promises.
That by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature.
Uh-huh.
Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust.
Okay, good. So qualification there is this. He has called us to glory and virtue. Born again. He has given us. His divine power has given us all the presence of God. According to. He has called us. Okay. Knowledge of him that called us. That's salvation. Then it says, because of this, he has given us these precious promises. These precious promises. Okay? So now, I want to just wrap this up by saying this. What stops you and I from receiving is two things. Number one, self-righteousness. Number one, self-righteousness. Lies to us about our qualification. Once you are born again, you are qualified. We've established that. Number two, knowledge. Yeah, that's why he's given us the keys. Read that again. Precious promises.
Precious promises. That by these you might be.
No,
you might
be, before that.
Okay. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. That by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust.
But before that, do you want me to go even before that? Verse 3?
Read that verse 4 again.
Okay. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises.
In order for us to enjoy these benefits, in order for us to enjoy these things that has been available through Christ's redemptive work, it says he has given unto us precious promises. So that by these, by them, we'll be able to partake, we'll be able to enjoy those things. That's what he's saying. So you see, the qualification for simply operating, asking and receiving is two things. Number one, born again, which you are not, if you are born again. Number two is simply this knowledge of the precious promises of what has been available to you. Number three, just go ahead and ask. Go ahead and ask. Are you born again? Do you know what the word of God says about his promises to you? And then number three, are you, ask. Okay, if you're born again, you know the promises of God, ask. Ask in faith. Ask in faith. I'll say four things. I cannot mention 2, 3, 4. That's fine. Born again, number one. Number two, know what the promises are. Number three, ask. Number four, ask in faith. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your word today. Thank you for the time we've spent learning from you. Thank you for instruction. Thank you for correction. Thank you for inspiration, motivation. Thank you for direction. Thank you for confirmation. Lord, even we are better people because we have heard from you today. And we're not going to be just hearers, we're going to be doers of the word. We're going to apply these scriptures, apply these principles in our daily lives so we can begin to partake that which you have made available to us. Thank you, Father, for loving us in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Now, do me a favor, as I'm about to arrive, watch this broadcast twice. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by God's word. Watch it twice. Then secondly, like it. And then or thirdly, share with somebody else. Make sure you share it. Okay? We've posted the links throughout. We'll show you the links. Just take the link and share it. Share it. My son is making noise because he's looking for food. Praise God. But share it. Share it. Amen. Share. Watch it twice. Like it and share with somebody else. It's so important. And if God has been a blessing to you and you want to be able to sow into this ministry, feel free to do so. We're going to post up the Cash App link right there. Cash App link, $ Fount of Life. Cash App link, $ Fount of Life. You know, but please make sure you watch. And don't forget, this week we're going to be talking about, you know, things concerning the voice of the Spirit of God. And then on Friday, 7 p.m., Saturday, 7 p.m., Sunday, 11 a.m., we're going to be dealing with hearing the voice of God, how to hear the voice of God. So going into the new year, it's very critical that you know what God is saying to you. You get to know what the will of God is and you get to be able to pursue it with confidence. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being a part of Voices of Love Sunday Worship. It's been my delight and pleasure to share with you today. I want to just encourage you, enjoy your week, enjoy the rest of your Sunday as you go into next week. God is with you. Until we see you again next time. Look forward to seeing you. Until then, be blessed.